Bueno, pues os voy a presentar. I am going to. Bueno, he's going to speak for you about his David Arcos, and he's going to speak about how to use Python referring to into the program airplanes. Yes, and I think he.
Te he quitado todo.
Te lo estoy mirando. And, bueno, pues eso. That's all. If you need something.
Thank you very much. Gracias. Hi, hello, welcome. Faster. Thanks. Hi, this is Python in the Sky, a presentation about a use case of how we build a wireless in-flight entertainment system using Python, okay? The talk will be divided in three sections. First, the product requirements, then the architecture decisions we took, and at the end, atypical challenges, strange stuff you don't see unless you are working with airplanes, okay? So this is who I am, well, like 10 years ago. I'm David Arcos from Barcelona. I have been a Django and Python developer since 2008. I am co-organizer of Python Barcelona. We do a monthly meetup, so if you come to Barcelona, you are welcome. And I am lead engineer at Immfly. What's Immfly? Immfly is a startup from Barcelona. We do wireless in-flight entertainment, and we sell it to airlines, okay? So let's start with the product. What's the wireless in-flight entertainment? How does it work? Okay, the idea is that the passenger inside the plane, with their own device, they connect to our Wi-Fi and open the app, okay? And then they have a lot of services inside. So they can use any kind of device, laptops, tablets, smartphones, whatever. They connect to our Wi-Fi, which is inside the plane. It's internal, intranet, no internet, okay? And they open the app. The most used app is the web app. It's just a normal website, but we also have mobile apps, okay? So what kind of services do we provide inside the plane? It's more or less the same kind of services we used to have years ago in a physical way, but nowadays it's digital. So first of all, flight information, okay? You can see a very nice map, where do you have the plane, your destination, weather at destination, flight altitude, whatever, speed, external temperature. Damn Windows. It's not mine. Okay, so you can see videos, TV shows, kids videos, music videos, all kind of videos. You can read stuff, newspapers, magazines. You can get stuff about the destination, city guides, offers, deals. This is customized for each city you are flying to, right? And more stuff. The problem is that the airplane, when it's flying, it's offline. Okay, and some services require some kind of connectivity. In example, if you want to book a service, if you want today's newspaper, it has to be the newspaper from today, so you have to synchronize. Or if you want to pay to download coupons and then redeem it, okay, so you need eventual connectivity. This means that when the airplane lands, then we connect to the internet, to our platform, and we do stuff, okay? So the requirement was to update the contents. Nobody wants yesterday's newspapers. Send bookings and reservation actions to external APIs from other providers. Do payments, very important. If there is no payments, there is no money. And send emails, welcome emails, spam email, everything. Also, another big requirement was the ground mode. So you have the service inside the plane, but once you land, you should keep being able to use it, right? So it's the same experience before you fly inside the plane and then later. You can bring the contents, some contents with you. You can bring magazines and newspapers, but not videos because of, well, licensing. You get email confirmations, okay? The idea is that you get into your destination and from the hotel you can access the maps, see the nearby restaurants, whatever. Bring your coupons that you downloaded. Okay, so now the interesting part, the architecture, okay? How we built this system. I will go layer by layer, top down, from the most external one to the most internal. Okay, this is a simplification. It's a bit more complex, but it gives you a good idea of the different layers. So what happens in the airplane, the front end and back end, the system services we're using, and the hardware. And then after the airplane, what happens outside? Okay, we have a data center with machines. We call it the hangar, very imaginative, and we do processes and stuff there. So let's start from the most external part, the front-end applications. Users have a device, they open the website, that's a web app. It's done using AngularJS and SAS for the CSS and Grunt for integrating. Angular, if you don't know it, it's a JavaScript framework which is used to call an API, it gets the data, and that's it. You don't need a backend to implement Angular, okay? It's done just in JavaScript. The mobile apps, Android and iOS, no surprise here. And all of these apps, these three apps, use the same API from the backend, okay? So in the backend, I think you already know these technologies, Python, Django, and Django REST framework. They are very, very useful to implement Django REST framework. It's awesome, and we did the API very fast, and it's easy to maintain. We use Django for a lot of things. It has a lot of features, and it was very useful. And also some Python scripts for some different things. The system services. This is for the web server. We use this as a very typical configuration in Ginks as a web server, and also for the static contents, images, videos, PDFs, whatever. Unicorn as a whisky server, which is the standard server for Python. And Supervisor is a nice daemon that monitors and controls many things. So the idea is that your Django code is run in Unicorn, but Supervisor is calling it. We use it for the API. From some daemons, we have some agents that do stuff like synchronization and fixing inconsistencies, and also for Celery, for asynchronous tasks. Databases, Postgres and Redis, no surprises here. Postgres, very useful for SQL data because, well, with Django, if you are using the ORM and you want to use it because of the Django admin, very, very easy, fast, and reliable. And also for critical transactions. As we are doing payments, we have to be very sure that we don't lose anything, okay? Redis for the NoSQL data. We have many use cases here. For the sessions, in example, for everything in cache, any kind of data that expires, and also for metrics. You can do a lot of stuff inside Redis each time you do an API call. Okay. Networking. This is the SSH icon. All the aircrafts are connected to the central point, the hangar, when they land. So they use SSH. Everything is securized. We do some tricks to make it still safer. So we go through a VPN. It's not available in the internet. We hide the ports. We only use private key authentication. And on top of SSH, we have two services, Ansible and Fabric. Both are Python, very nice. Fabric is a bit more simpler. It's a way to call commands on top of SSH. So you have some libraries in Fabric, and you can do all kind of stuff. And for deploying things, copying configurations, initializing machines, very, very useful when you have a big fleet of several machines. We are doing the transition from Fabric to Ansible. Now we have both. Ansible is very useful for updating deploys. If you want to deploy new code, if you want to do config management, an example, I want to update the Redis configuration of all machines, this will take care. And we are using the pull mode. This is important. Usually in Ansible, you execute it as push, so you say now execute in these 10 machines. But as we are using airplanes that are offline and they only get connectivity when they land, we cannot do that, because we would need to wait until the plane arrives, and that's a lot of time and it's not viable. So the pull mode makes that when the airplane is online, it just gets the last version of code configuration from the repository and installs it, okay, with every version of every software we need. However, this is interesting. This is an airplane. In the airplane, we have, you can see here, the three access points, normal routers, and also the computer we're using. It's an embedded computer. So keep in mind this idea, okay? The different devices connect to one of these three APs. The AP is connected to the server. Wireless access points, we use three. They provide the Wi-Fi, very simple here, and they isolate each user so a user cannot see the traffic from the other users. Wouldn't matter, we are using SSL, but just in case, so they can't map the network or whatever. And this is a WAP in the lab. Then this connects to the aircraft server. This is an embedded computer, racked, military grade, hardened, very, very, very reliable. This is certified, so it won't catch fire. It won't, I don't know, do an electrical problem. It's very, very reliable. Very, very expensive. Certified means expensive. We use Shen with virtual machines. We have Ubuntu because it came with Ubuntu, so we have support. And it has in the picture you can't see it, but it has a 3G data card just like your cell phone, but with a lot of gigabytes, which are used when the airplane lands to connect to internet and get more stuff and push data. Also, very important, the avionics boost that we will see a bit later, okay? So this is the server that we have to install in each plane, connected to the three WAPs, and here runs everything. The avionics bus, this is a connection to the airplane, and we get information from here, okay? This is only read, not write. So we can get information, but we cannot write. No, I'm not kidding. This is important because there has been many news media that say that hackers can go into airplanes and get control of the plane and do stuff like shut down the engines or whatever, okay? Not possible. Even if they hack all our software, I mean, it's read only. You cannot write there, okay? So this is very important. Even if the wireless, the SSL, our software, the virtual machines, even if they get 0 days for everything, you can't write here. So this is, if you are used to developing mobile, you have some information. We are connected to the airplane and we have a lot of information on everything that happens there, okay? The altitude, the IDs, pitch, yaw, roll. If you play flight simulator, this is the same. We are calling it each minute and it's very, very reliable. We use this to, when we show the flight info, it's a map like a Google map, but using OpenStreetMaps, looks the same. So we paint the airplane there with the right direction, where you are going, where you are coming from, and we are using this data. And people love it. Also, discrete time signals. I don't know what this means, but we are using this for some events. In example, if an airplane is touching the floor, okay, they have weight on them, and if they open the main door or they close it, we get a signal, and then our computer, automatically it cuts the internet or starts the internet. To be certified, you have to implement these things, okay? So from these signals, we can know if the airplane is flying or if it's grounded, and then we can use the connection, okay? But don't ask me, because I would have no idea. Okay, the hangar. This is outside the plane. This is in the internet, in a cloud platform. The airplanes are also a cloud platform in the actual clouds. But it's a central point for the platform to synchronize everything. It orchestrates the operations. Each time a plane lands, sends the update, how many users registered, how many payments, whatever actions they did. It gets new contents, updated magazines, videos, whatever they need, new versions of the databases, new versions of the users, everything, even the code. Yeah, some operations we do, of course, manual operations. We do from the airplane outside. We have a lot of processes that ingest stuff from other sources. We have processes that send data to providers to do bookings or whatever. And we have an administration tool so our people can add offers and edit stuff. So airplanes, when they land, and only then, they send their information and get new data, okay? An example, ingesting new resources. We are uploading thousands of resources each month from a bit more than 20 providers. Different languages. Right now it's in Spanish, German, and English, and we are doing French, Italian soon. Per country, because different countries have different magazines, and also per category. Video, readings, deals. The funny thing is that some external APIs from external providers they suck. Okay, they don't give you documentation. They are not using HTTPS. They are using an FTP that maybe the intern uploads manually each night. They give you Excels. That's the worst part in all the project, but it's not done inside the airplane, so it's easier to manage. If you get errors here, it's easier. It's not critical. If you cannot ingest a magazine, I mean, whatever. The videos, we usually ingest them from SVTP or S3 in Amazon, and then we use a tool called Amazon Elastic Transcoder, which is a platform as a service where you send videos in any format and you choose the output and they produce the right version for you. We're using HLS, which is very useful for mobile devices, okay? And it works also on web, Android, iOS. And the synchronization is done chunk by chunk. This means that the video has a lot of pieces, and when synchronizing, we do it piece by piece, because if we wanted to upload a video of 200 megabytes at once, I mean, it's not possible, because the airplane stops for maybe 10, 15 minutes, and you don't get much connectivity. So the video is synchronized chunk by chunk, then it loses connectivity, then later starts again, okay? For readings, magazines and newspapers, we ingest from the same places, different directories, and we are using celery tasks. Celery is a process to execute a synchronous task. Okay, so you say ingest this PDF from the server, and then you do different processes on top. The most important are to reduce size, because they love to give you PDFs of 100 megabytes. It's massive for our poor network. Also to generate thumbnails, because everybody wants to see the thumbnail inside the application. I should have put more screenshots. And last, the ground mode. The ground mode means that as I told you before, when the aircraft lands, the passenger gets outside and can do similar things, okay? They open an application which looks the same. Web, mobile, and iOS, web, Android, and iOS, they all look the same. We take care in the details, and in ground, it looks mostly the same. Some minor differences, no videos. We cannot stream this kind of content in the internet. We are focused on destinations offers, because if you are going to a city, you get info from that city, from restaurants and places surrounding you. Some functionalities that only work online, like the forgot my password. You have all the magazines, you have the tickets you bought, so it's very easy to, you are in the plane, you get a restaurant offer, and then later from the app you have it there, and you can just use it. And the control point here is that in the aircraft, I mean, we are using A320s, which have like 180 passengers, okay? That's for a web platform, that's very easy to scale. But in around we can have thousands of users at the same time. We are not there yet, but it's made to scale. And the last part, the funny one, atypical challenges. When you are working with aircrafts, you have some specific perks, good things, bad things, but it's different that we were used to, okay? There are some extra challenges and problems that we weren't expecting. We had no idea, and also we did some mistakes, then we fixed them. So the first one is the regulations and certification. Why are we doing this product now and not a few years ago? Because at the end of 2013, the EASA did a regulation that allowed all personal electronic devices to be turned on inside the plane, okay? Even in landing and in takeoff, okay? Previously, you couldn't. You could only turn them on while you were flying. So this law that was implemented in all Europe the following year allowed us to do this product. Since this law, at the end of 2013, it took like 1 year, and at the end of 2014, we were already having some two or three airplanes with our product flying. Okay, the day we got the notification, we did the first flight, and it was awesome. So you have to certify every step you do, even if the hardware is already certified, even if the access points are already certified. You have to do a lot of stress tests, wireless tests, everything. Okay? The aviation industry is very conservative, and you have to be very, very safe and slow. Even the smallest screw, not kidding. This is each hole we do in the airplane to put cables or whatever, everything has to be certified, procedures, and it's very, very slow. Took us 6 to 9 months just to get the certification, which was good, because then we had time to do the implementation, okay? A typical project, you sell it to the customer, and then you have to implement it. So we had 9 months to implement everything, and it was awesome. In the first flight, everything worked perfectly. But the certifications are boring. Intermittent connectivity, this is a technical issue. We thought the airplanes would be connected all the time. It would be a typical project. We would have a lot of time at night, a few hours to do upgrades and everything manually. No way. Each day, we get like an hour of connectivity. Okay, each airplane, when it lands, it stays for maybe half an hour, so we have 10-15 minutes of connectivity, because they shut down the computers many times, so we don't have a lot of time to do synchronizations and updates. Also, there is the roaming. That means that if you send data, it costs you a lot, so we have to do a limited mode when we are in countries where we don't have roaming. So what we had to do here was to improve a lot our deployment tools and to optimize the performance of the synchronizations, doing things like AirSync or like the chunks in video, going step by step, progressing a lot too. So this was a big issue, because you are not used to a distributed system which works offline, and you don't get access to update stuff. Okay. Hard shutdown. This is maybe the worst. Well, no, the worst will be shown later. Hard shutdown means there is not a shutdown procedure, so they just click the button or it gets disconnected and the hardware gets very beaten. So the electrical power is suddenly removed. Now our server is turned off, and this is awesome for corrupting file systems and everything. Happens very often, many times a day, when they change the power, in example, the airplane lands and they shut down the engines, so we have no electricity, and they connect an external power source. In that microsecond, bam, reset. The hardware is supposed to manage that, but, well, marketing. And also, the pilot has a very nice button on top, so they can disconnect our service. Okay, if there is a storm or bad meteorology, they can shut it down. The regulation says they can shut it down with a lot of non-critical services. But most of it is when changing the power source. Okay, here we can do nothing, just mitigate it. If the service gets corrupted, where we are using virtual machines, so the host machine is never changed. We are only changing an internal virtual machine. So if it gets corrupted, we have to fix the inconsistencies, okay? This was our first mistake. We trusted the hardware, but the file system got corrupted a lot. Some files were lost, some other had size zero, so the contents were deleted. It was very fun. You run FSCK at start, so it checks for it's a file system checker, it checks for corrupted things in the hard drive, and as we are using virtual machines, it's doable. And also, when deploying, each time we deploy a big file or small files, whatever we deploy, we do a sync. A sync is an operating system command that forces the operating system to flash the caches of the hard drives, of the memory, everything, to disk. Okay, so you do a sync, and then you are 100% guaranteed that it will write to the disk. This is good, because this has saved us a lot of problems. Anyways, it can be shut down while you are doing the sync, and you lose the data anyways, okay? So you have to compensate for that. Also, as it was very typical, we have some consistency checks. We check all the time for the contents, if they have a size equal to zero, or if they don't exist anymore, because sometimes you download a video with some chunks, and then some chunks disappear, okay? So once you update and say, okay, this content is now available, you still have to check it again. Another, this was very minor, the internal clock got corrupted. The logs were funny because it showed wrong times. At the same time, it was in two flights, these kind of things. So we added some NTP checks. NTP is the service for updating the clock. Goes to the internet, checks to the master clocks, and updates the internal clock. Requires connectivity, so we are only doing it when it lands. And yeah, this is the funny stuff. The cap theorem. How many of you know the cap theorem? Please raise your hands. Okay. Good. Cap theorem is a theorem in distributed systems that says that you cannot have all three. You can only have two. Okay. The three are consistency. So all the nodes in your platform see the same stuff. In our case, all the airplanes have the same contents. Availability, that every node is able to give a response. In our case, all airplanes are working. And partition tolerance. If there is a network partition, the platform is still working. Network partition means that maybe you have three data centers, you get one data center out, and you still have service with some machines or with all. Okay, so CAP, our big mistake was to ignore it. CAP, you can have C and A and P, or C and P. Okay, if you try to beat it and have the three of it, you will have a bad time. We tried to, because of course consistency was a requirement. We wanted all the planes to have all the time the last version, all the users, all the contents, the last database. Availability, because a plane being offline has to work. partition tolerance, by default, we already have this because each plane is partitioned from the network, it's offline. So from default, we have the partition tolerance, and then we wanted the availability. So at the end, we took out the consistency. Okay, so right now our system allows for availability and partition tolerance and works much better. It works. So this means we settle for eventual consistency. That means, in our case, maybe an airplane has an old version of the software, of the database, of the contents. Doesn't matter. Maybe today it didn't have time to download the last new paper. Doesn't matter. It still works. Okay? It will eventually fix itself because it will keep synchronizing each time it lands. So if you design a distributed system, keep this in mind. It's important. Okay. Recapitulation. We did a complex project with lots of features. I have only shown a few, but it's really complex. We have 20-something Django applications in our project, okay? So this can give you an overview of the scale. We kept a modular design, doing different apps and keeping the stuff in different places. We could implement everything, and we were helped a lot by the existing libraries. And there were unexpected challenges. We learned how to fix them. It was difficult at the first, but now we have learned a lot. The conclusions are that Python made it possible. It's very versatile, so we can use it at 10,000 meters. Covers all our use cases. We have done this because we stand on shoulders of giants, which means all the software stack we already have allows us to do the last part and to integrate different things together. And it was developed in a very short time because the implementation happened for like 6 months. Since then, we have been adding new features, of course. We need more bugs to fix, so we need to add features, and we will keep adding them. But it's very agile, it's very fast to implement. And that's it. Thanks for attending. I will post the slides a few minutes later. I will tweet them. And in Immfly, we are hiring. Visit that page and see if something there fits you. Now you have questions. Yeah. I'm not the sysadmin, I don't know. Okay. More questions?
This works now?
Thank you. Hi. I have a question regarding the aviation bus. How is it connected to your system? Is it IP-based or anything special?
It's a bus called ARINC. I don't know the specifics. It's a bus called ARINC. Our computer gets a cable and it's connected, and that's it. We do polling each minute. It updates each minute. And once you connect, you keep getting data, and you cannot ask for data. You just listen everything it sends you. I don't know the specifics. But if you look for ARINC, it's a standard, and that's it.
Okay, thank you. And the second one, where is it deployed? So which flight I have to book to see this?
Again, sorry?
Where is the system deployed? So in which flight or which company
okay,
I can see this?
Right now we are deployed in Iberia Express, okay, which is from the IAG group. We did a first phase since last December of 6 months. It was a pilot phase with 4 airplanes. It was a success, so now we are deploying in more airplanes on that airline. Right now we are in 8 airplanes, and we will start with other airlines from the same group.
Okay, thank you again.
Welcome. It's very expensive to deploy this kind of stuff because the hardware is expensive. You have to do a lot of operations. You have to deal with certifications. So we have to go one step at a time.
You said that there are problems with power outages. So have you even considered using like a battery or something? Or is that no way because of the certifications?
Certification again. We look to put capacitors or something, but certifying that would take like half a year and we didn't have time. Eventually, we will do something like that. But the hardware we had, it said in the marketing prospect that it already had some internal batteries. It's not enough.
I see. And the other question, you said that you're using Ansible in the pull mode, so it's pulling down the changes and applying them to the system, I guess.
Yes.
So what if something goes wrong with the actual system and then therefore it can't pull the data, or you know, how do you fix that?
Then we it hasn't happened, okay? But then we would need to connect to the machine via SSH, via the hangar, and then do stuff there. We have had other kind of problems that led to this, installing a bad deploy that then does a migration of the database, and bam, no more service. But with Ansible, I mean, it's very small, the thing we are doing. It's a very small repository. It's updating all the time, so shouldn't have problems.
Okay, you said that you decided to scrub off consistency. So what are you planning to do when the user count spikes? So there is a login system inside the plane. So each plane has the complete database of users.
Yes.
So what will happen when you have, I don't know, 1 billion users?
You're asking for the worst case.
Well, what you have in mind or what's...
Right now, the worst case, and we have this case, is that the same user takes a flight, it lands, we don't have time to do a synchronization, okay? And then maybe he takes another plane and he doesn't have the user in the second plane, okay? That happens sometimes. And then when we get from airplane one, user, from airplane two, same user, we have to do like a merge of the inconsistencies. This is done manually right now. It's not very very often, mostly with pilots. They use the app, but maybe I shouldn't say that. Not while flying, later. When. But the problem exists. We settled for it. I mean, we cannot do anything else. We can do a better merge procedure, but right now, It's good as it is.
And the second question, I'm curious, are you allowed to record any kind of events from the plane and then upload them to your servers?
Events, like user events, yes.
No, user events, but plane events, like the database of the...
We were thinking on that because we have all the data from the Aring bus and we could export a safe game for Flight Simulator, something like that. We could do, if you know Flight Radar 24, which is a nice application that shows the airplanes, we could do the same because we have all the GPS positions of our planes, and then at the end we could do some big data magic and know some stuff about how many each flight takes, about, I don't know, this kind of stuff. But right now we are a small team, we are a startup, we don't have much time for these funny things. Someday we will do it. We are saving all the data, and someday we will do these things.
But the main question is not if you are actually doing it, but if you are allowed to do it.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah?
Yeah.
So the airline is all right with...
Yeah. The trouble is with user data, with emails, but with the flight information, I mean, it's public.
It's public.
If you go to Flight Radar 24, you can see where each plane is.
Well, but not only that. I mean, the doors,
the doors. No, of course, no. But I mean, what can I do with the doors? I want to see on the maps the pretty stuff.
No, but I mean, you could. I don't know. Well, that would be a bit stupid. Calculating. I don't know that user retention when there is turbulences.
I will ask.
They enjoy the movie more or something.
I will ask. Thanks. Do we have time for more questions?
4 minutes.
4 minutes. Faster.
You said you had to respect a lot of regulations to be able to launch this, but how did you do the proof of concept tests for the system? Like, how did you put the first server in a plane and make sure that it actually works?
Because we have the picture of the embedded computer, we have that at our office at the lab, and with that we can do simulations. In the wireless access point down there, we had a simulator that you just push buttons and it's like an airplane. So we have one that is the door, the other is the ground.
Okay, and is this the same way that you test when you do updates for the synchronization part using the simulator?
More or less, it's the same, but obviously it failed big time, because in the office you have good connectivity, yes. You don't test for some things, and then in the planes we thought that we would have like 4 hours, 5 hours of connectivity each day, and now we have like 1 hour. We are not even spending the 3G data on our plan, okay? So that's a problem. But yeah, testing is not the same as production.
So how come you get so little connectivity? Because I've observed that when a plane lands and it connects to the gate, a couple hundred people get out, they clean the plane, a couple hundred people get back on. That takes more than an hour. Why are you only getting 90 minutes of connectivity a day if you're at the gate for an hour, like 3 times a day?
They do a lot of operations. They are maybe putting fuel and they have to turn down the electricity. I don't know the specifics, but I know, and I have the data for that, that it maybe we have 5-20 minutes or nothing at all, or maybe someday we have an hour, but you cannot predict that. Okay, so there is no way to predict that. There was a question at the end.
I want to ask, so I know on some transatlantic flights, for example, they have Wi-Fi on board while in flight. Can that be used for synchronization, for example? And so you can get more online time for the app and like do the updates?
I don't know, maybe.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks. Well, that's it. Thanks for coming.
Yes, thank you for coming.
Cerrar la puerta para que no entren. Pues no. Pero lo que no es decir es cerrar, no dejarles. Sorry.